Mitchell, qui travaille au Sun, l'a lui-même bien connu. Il était skin à la naissance du mouvement. Il nous a déballé ses souvenirs, une nostalgie d'un goût incertain.
In 68, skinheads had two basic looks. This is the generalized, but there were two basic looks. One was the daytime look and the stuff he wore for football. So you'd have a donkey jacket, you'd have jeans, heavy jeans, Levi's. You'd have Dr. Martin boots or steel capped industrial boots. And you'd wear your scarf like a cravat. And that was the look for fighting or for, you know, it was fighting and fashion were the main preoccupations apart from girls. And, you know, I think fighting more than anything, it was part of the gang culture. I remember, I used to hate the hippies. You know, when people say packy bashing, that was a very small element of it. There was also hippie bashing, there was queer bashing. Anyone who was a little bit different, anyone who wasn't young and working class was a target, really.
The illusion.
Just about over there. I'll show you.
West Indian Scar was the real skinhead music, and the Tighten Up Volume 2 was the biggest selling of all the Tighten Up albums, a compilation of various reggae numbers. Reggae evolved out of Scar and Rock Steady and Bluebeat. And this had some of the great skinhead classics, Long Shot Kick the Bucket by the and the Reggae in Your Jiggae, Return of Dwango by the Upsetters. These were the real, these were the things that we used to dance to in the club. You see, skinheads, it was a very territorial thing. Skinheads spent a lot of time fighting. I mean, but most of the fighting was around football, and most of it was territorial. And so the immigrants they attacked tended to be Pakistani, because they were the kids who weren't cool. They were the kids who were... the culture clash was there. It wasn't really a racial thing, it was a cultural thing. And, you know, that was a funny thing. It always used to make me laugh about Rock Against Racism. Their slogan was black and white, unite and fight. Well, in skinheads, black and white kids were uniting to fight Pakistanis, which is quite an irony.
Le photographe Red Saunders a fondé Rock Against Racism en Angleterre pour lutter contre le National Front.
I had, to my amazement, heard a speech made by Eric Clapton at a gig in Birmingham when he said he didn't want any foreigners in the country. I mean, and Enoch Powell would make a great leader. And I was flabbergasted because, you know, I'd been a little bit, I wasn't a great Eric Clapton fan, but, you know, I was a real fan of rhythm and blues, and I'd... So I wrote this letter to New Musical Express, Melody Maker, Black Echoes, the whole music press, just saying I was fucking outraged. And I basically said, what on earth is Eric Clapton talking about? Here's a man that's made all his money from the blues, from black music, you know, and I said, I want to form a popular rank-and-file campaign called Rock Against Racism, where just ordinary fans can stop this outrageous bloody filth and hypocrisy. And I wrote, P.S. Shot the sheriff, Eric, it sure as hell wasn't you.
It was I who shot the sheriff, but I did not deputy. I didn't shoot no deputy. It goes like this. All around in my hometown, they are trying to track me down. They say they want to bring I am guilty for the life of a deputy. For the life of a deputy now. But I swear, if I am guilty, I will say, I shot the sheriff.
So I sent off this little letter, you know. And to my amazement, I had about 400 letters back over the next 3 weeks. And that's how Rock Against Racism started. The seeds were set for this extraordinary period of the late 70s, because without doubt that skinhead movement was enormous. And in the 1976 general local elections, and the National Front were the third largest vote in London. Our job was to unequivocally say that these people are Nazis. What the bottom line actually meant is they're going to pour petrol through an Asian family's bloody letterbox and burn them to death. Burn fucking children. That's what they're going to do. Forget all this fucking mamby-pamby stuff. These people hate people just because of their colour of their skin, their religion. And that's an idea that touched a lot of people.
But don't forget, you know, both the extreme right and the extreme left try to approach the skinheads. You're talking about a lot of disaffected kids, a lot of them, you know, the Sham 69, what have we got, fuck all.
Break his NF skin following. That was an extraordinary evening. We put on the stage together Sham 69 and Misty, the best roots reggae band in the country.
Get on! Come on! Come on!
And they were confronted by an audience of 800 skinheads. Ideologically and tactically, the point is to smash. You've got to break the hard racist from the soft racist.
It was actually the younger Nazis who were skinheads who actually had to argue with the older ones to get it accepted.
Because what was essential to the campaign of the Anti-Nazi League, which is one of the failures in France in the confronting Le Pen in the Front National, is that we said that the National Front, wherever they meet, must be physically confronted, and that this was the lesson of fascism of the 30s. It was Adolf Hitler himself who said that if only our enemies had crushed us when we were 22.
This is a replica of the Excalibur sword from Alfieri. That was the sword that Arthur pulled from the rock. That is just, again, both made by Franklin Mint Company over here. A charge of the Scots Greys at Waterloo. Of course, that was a turning point in European history, stopping the Napoleon's empire just as we were late to stop Hitler's empire. And hopefully Jack Delors' empire.